And then I'll get to the bookmobile program. So I don't forget, though, we have two important people here. One, we have the last of the bookmobile drivers. You know, we had the last of this, Tony Thrush Rider, and all those, but we also have the last of the bookmobile driver in Door County. And we also have the person who bought the bookmobile, who I didn't really, I know was coming, but I kind of thought he might show up. That's John Enigo, so he's here. So I just wanted to introduce those two people, so I definitely don't forget that. And the third person is our new library director. I assume people might be walking in, giving out Tina, so don't worry about it. I told them I wouldn't embarrass them or anything like that. So I'm going to introduce you to Tina, and she's giving you her last name, the director of the Door County Library.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Tina Kukuski. I'm the director of Door County Library, and I want to thank you so much for celebrating National Library Week with us by visiting your local library here in Egg Harbor. The public library is truly your open house, as it is many things to many people. It's a resource for assistance, knowledge, entertainment, and a sense of community. And I'm sure you all know that libraries have changed a lot over the years, and they continue to evolve, because it used to be a place where there were just books and information, which was fabulous, and it still is. But it's also a place where you can get a fast connection to the internet, you can get e-books, e-videos, informational databases, genealogy resources, which are very popular now, DVDs and CDs. But it's also a place where people gather to talk about books, to watch films, to meet their neighbors, and this makes it a community place. The Egg Harbor Library is a perfect example of a community place. And once upon a time, the library came to you. Today is National Bookmobile Day, and bookmobiles are actually making a comeback. So it really makes sense for us to learn about the Door County Library bookmobile. And I want to turn the program over to Giz Herbst, who will take us through the history of the Door County bookmobile.
About that. Now, the next thing is technology. And it worked yesterday. There we go. The bookmobile. The bookmobile, Door County bookmobile, dating service now, not just talking about one bookmobile, 1950 to 1996. 46 years in any of your lives. Now, how many of you actually used bookmobile? Let's see those hands. Okay, we're close to half of us. That means the rest of us are going to find out about the bookmobile, including me. I've been on a bookmobile twice. Once at John's Farm, when I went to the park there, we purchased it, we're getting ready to move it. Once in Carlsville, where it's being restored, because John left about 2,000 books on the bookmobile, we had to get them out. So I was there working one day, holding out books. So the bookmobile process is more than just a one bookmobile deal. Okay. How come it didn't work that way yesterday? Okay, bookmobiles. There were libraries in Door County a long time ago. They were called box in a book. Books in a box. Not a box in a book. Books in a box. I just have a couple of them where I found in the Advocates, 1903, 1907, over in Sawyer. Some of you people may not know where Sawyer is. For us people that grew up in Sturgeon Bay, that's on the other side of the bridge. couple of others here, Sturgeon had some boxes in the book, and Sister Bay, you can find them any place, Barker Lumber Company. In Egg Harbor, the very first library I started doing research for a project I'm doing for the May 19th opening on the library, the first library in Egg Harbor was down at Fat Louie's. Olive Oil, right downtown, in the yellow building, Dr. Ames' office. He had, in 1901, Professor Allen, who had come to Ann Carter, he died, and his wife from Madison would donate books, and they were kept in a box at Dr. Ames' office. So everyone thought the first library was across at the Paul Virchinger Center, and it wasn't. It was downtown. Some of them thought it was down at Danhauser's old stage, where it was for a while. That wasn't the first one. It was at Dr. Ames' office. Going on then with the bookmobile program, why did I get involved, or how did I get involved? A gal who was the head of the library program down in Madison wrote a book. This is it. We have a copy of it. It's in our history center downstairs, the Historical Society History Room. You can't check it out, but you can take it and sit down in one of the lounge chairs and read it and come back and finish it up. It's an excellent book. It has a very long title, Literacy, Democracy, and the Public Library in Cold War America. There's a big section in here, a big section on the Door County experience. Christine Pauley was her name, and when I started doing research on that, on the bookmobile, I was going to the Laurie Center and talking to Laura, and she directed me to that book, and also to a number of binders. When I started going through these book binders, I found tabs on all these pages exactly what I was looking for. She probably sent up a graduate student to Sturgeon Bay to do research and had it already marked for me. Now, I'm only going to deal with the bookmobile and what it was. I'm not going to deal with the politics, because we've got enough of that going on. I'm going to deal with what happened, what occurred. I'm not going to do why or how I did. That's politics. If you want to hear the politics, I'll be giving this program in July 23rd at Lincoln Smith. I'll deal then with the politics as well. So I use this resource, and we have it available for you if you're interested. What was happening is that the reason why she wrote this book is she found some research that in 1948-49, the university was doing research on what was happening with the reading population in Wisconsin. It was declining, and they wanted to do some research on this. So they were developing a project, and I'm kind of summarizing a lot of things I'll be covering in July, but they wanted a study done, a demonstration project. So they checked the counties, and there's 72 counties, and they picked two of them that are fairly close. Can't get any closer than Door and Kewaunee. Fairly close in the Democrats, the Southern Door County and Kewaunee County were very similar. A lot of rural farming areas. But yet different in Door County. Once you get to Door County, that's north of the bridge, right? Once you get to Door County, yeah, of course, it changes. So they wanted to study this and see what would happen. And this was 1948-49. They were similar, but they were different. So they went through this process of doing a research project. And also then, out of that, Christine wrote that book, but it's probably one a shorter version. It's also in the Wisconsin History Magazine. So those are available in our history room downstairs. This project, as it says, was going to be from the summer of 1952 all year, 51 and 52. 50, 51, and 52. Reading Resistance in the Door County Regional Library. This library service that was doing the research wanted to provide a bookmobile experience because of the rural aspect of it. They were concerned that people out in the country weren't getting the experience that they needed. I want to just pause here, because they're kind of emphasizing the rural. Bookmobiles didn't start in the country. I had that assumption. adoption. Bookmobiles started in the big cities. Racine, Madison, why? Because back in that, they had one library. One library in the middle of Madison is pretty hard for the kids on the outskirts of Madison to get to it. So bookmobiles actually started in the larger cities. But then you can think of Door County as a large city. So they want to provide service with an experienced librarian to areas remote from libraries, even in the city. But we're concerned about Door County. I'm just going through a few things here, cutting it off because we don't want to spend like a whole 2 hours here. But up on the screen, I've got a note that comes that the Door County Amphitheater on August 25th, 1949 said, "The bookmobile is at the county fair." Okay? And our librarian at that time was Miss Jane Livingston. And she started a campaign because they're going to do this research project between Kewaunee and Door County. Wheels of Learning Keeps on Turning was her little slogan. And she was out to promote this. Because number one, the legislator down in Madison, they actually had okayed budgeting money for this program. But it wouldn't go unless the two counties also passed it, because it was a shared project. Madison or the state was going to pay for half of it, Door County half, Kewaunee County half. Anyone from Kewaunee County? Well, then I can talk about it because we paid more than they did. they didn't cut their share. But that's where Door County people are. After promoting the prospect of a bookmobile service, we're talking about right here, she had a borrowed bookmobile. She was promoting this with her logo. She went to the Door County Fair. She went to visit all the schools in Door County, and most of them in Kewaunee County before they ran out, because there's going to be a referendum in November. And this is from the Door County, November 25th, 1949, advocate. There's only a prospect. Madison said, go ahead, but Door County and Kewaunee County had to say the same thing. So the county boards of each of these had to pass this before it actually happened. This is the bookmobile that she used. It was a borrowed bookmobile. Maybe some of you will start to see this. It was not 1949 county fair. And that she would take it also out into the various schools. Any of you go to Cherry School? Well, Cherry, this is a picture from Cherry School. So some of you want to find out who these kids are. Garden Kewaunee Economies were granted that project. State funding was $28,500. As already mentioned, it's supposed to be split between the other two, but Door County picked up the remaining. Now, most, not the remaining cost, but a good portion of it. Granting the bookmobile project was just a formality with the legislature. Kewaunee passed it in the morning, the county board of supervisors. Door County passed it in the vote with a vote of 15 to 4 in the afternoon. So now we were in business, except we didn't have bookmobiles. Okay? So we had to get bookmobiles. Two Chevrolet chassis were ordered. You couldn't go to Bergstrom's or Jimbo's by a bookmobile. There was a company in Worcester, Ohio that made specialty vehicles. So I know Fellhofer Garage and Bellamy got the bid for the Door County one. And I forgot the name, I think it was a Lee or a Lay in Luxembourg got the bid for the Kewaunee County area. And they were then taken down to Worcester to be built into bookmobiles. Here they are. And as you can see, they are red, yellow, and gray. much sharper colors than the bookmobile that we now have, which is brown, brown, and brown. The state mandate was that you had to provide a librarian with the driver. So on each of these, there are two people going out. Everything was staged out of the library. Everything came out of the library, even those that went down to Kewaunee, Ogoma, Lux, talking about, there's Andrew Krieger, well, James Livingston's on there, Jordan Badcock, James Thorpe, Robert Pale. They would take these books out on a regular schedule. The book will be on a regular schedule. And if you could move aside, you'd see the old Jennifer Bay Library behind it. This is the park down on Market Square. Their schedules, I know it's kind of hard for you in the back to see. I put two schedules on there, and these would change according to the time of year and according to the need or desire. On the left-hand side, for people in front, they have better eyes than I do, is one during the school year, April 19, 1954. Most of these are schools. One thing I found out in studying the library, and maybe Tina could tell me this, librarians don't work on Thursday. I never found a Thursday schedule. Okay, Tina? Always, never one. And when I gave this program to the Door County librarians, I had to do it on a Thursday because they all had off. Not all of them. Some of them had worked downstairs. But they never Thursday schedule. So you can see mostly schools, Egg Harbor School, Judville School, there in Haynesville School, Morning Star, Stevenson, Wanager. The right-hand side is the summer schedule. School's not in session, so they would see a different demand. You will now see more stores like Nibbitt Store, Judville, Egg Harbor, Horseshoe Bay. Egg Harbor would have been downtown here. And there were still some schools, so that would change throughout the year. When I started doing this research, I also started to look into the Door County Library archives on newspapers. They just started to open them up. Well, if I Google bookmobile now, I'd come up with over 2,000 hits, 2,000 pieces of pages in somewhere in a newspaper that library information is on. Some of those newspapers didn't even have an obituary, but they had the news, they had the bookmobile. So that's what was happening. So there was a sample schedule. Every newspaper once a week would have a schedule of the bookmobile and or a story on the bookmobile. It was important in Door County. Then we have a typical stop. Typical, except that, as I like to play amateur historian, it's curb and gutter. So it's not all the country. It's not at Kent in Rhode Island where I grew up. There was no curb and gutter there in 1950. Just a ditch. So we tried, Gary Bell and I on Monday tried to guess what this would be. Maybe Elmo or Kiwani. Or maybe Sawyer, the west side of Sturgeon Bay. Probably not the east side because that was close enough to the regular library. And while we were there, Gary and I were there, a fellow from Sturgeon Bay that we were both acquainted with was doing some work. I won't name him, but he was a banker, retired now. And he said, hey, I went to Corpus Christi. I was at Corpus Christi School. That stopped, and we went to the bookmobile there. So many people think this only pulled up to Egg Harbor or Nibbitt Store somewhere or whatever else. It was in the city, and as you can see here, curb and gutter. A couple other stops, this would have been either 1950, 51, or 52. Here's one that Gary and I kind of guessed that. Gary had an experience in the bookmobile. Anyone want to take a guess, you amateurs, where this is? Well, Gary and I tell you it's in Maplewood. Because you Sturgeon Bay should know that the tallest building, one of the tallest buildings in Egg Harbor. In Egg Harbor, what I'm talking about. Tallest buildings in Door County. It's a grain elevator. You should know that Sturgeon Bay. You had nothing but grain elevators. That's a grain elevator. And I remember the swing over the corner when I go by the. So we think it's Maplewood. Might have been Forest Hill, most likely Maplewood. So it hit the whole county. You want to be amateur historian, you want to kind of look for those things. This one we didn't know. This one, you know. You're going to give us a yeah, this is the Whitefish Bay. So it stopped up. This one looks like a gravel road coming in on the side. I don't know, it had to be a fairly decent approach, but you got trucks and people walking. And Gary mentioned in his interview that it was in the Peninsula House, by the way, if you didn't see it, get last Friday's Peninsula House. Gary had a great interview in there, and he'd say horses might show up. even the car ferry, the old rector. Now, I talked to Dixie Jorings, who was a librarian down in Third Bay, who was just retiring. She was from Washington. She remembers it coming, but not too often. I can kind of wonder why, because I don't know if I want to get on the rector too often either. So I went to Washington Island. So we hit the whole county. This is the inside of the bookmobile, typical, slanted shelves for a reason. Mm-hmm. So that when you go around the corner, the books don't slide off. Some kind of checkout in there somewhere. This is not the one that we have. And crowded with kids. One of my little icons that I like to use in our approach is this little guy right here. The way he may have been looking at the first time at the jungle in South America, or the mountains somewhere else, or the ocean. Remember, 1950, I don't know about you, but we didn't have a television set. So it was books. So this might have been his first experience with the outside world. Or if he was already in elementary school, what did he do? Read the book, See Jane Run. Look at Jane. So she got to know Jane, Dick, and Spock. Okay? Now she sees me. The mountains, the Andes, the whole world brought to him because of the bookmobile. After the first year, 1951, this is coming out of Madison, not performing or Kiwani. This is a Madison article. It says the circulation of the books and other reading materials amongst the rural people of the Kiwani North County increased 60% since they started this project. At the end of the project, 1950, 51, and 52, at the end of Project 52, that number had gone up to 160% increase in the use of reading materials. So remember when I started about that project, that back legislator, they were concerned about how things were decreasing, the reading was decreasing, and they thought they could prove that they could change that? They're changing it with the bookmobile. Now, the end of the line. If some of you are school people, like myself, when you have these funded programs, they run out. Now you have a choice. Do you drop them, or do you cover it yourself? So at the end of the program, after the three-year program, they had to decide whether they were going to do this or not in each of the counties. This was done by a referendum, not by the county supervisors. A referendum. Kiwani County voted no. They kind of did it in the first place. They kind of changed out on covering the cost. Door County people voted yes. Township that had the highest percentage for yes was Washington Island. They wanted to have books out there. So they immediately, the Door County supervisors got the message from the people. They designated $30,000 right away to cover the whole cost. They weren't going to chance on this. They did change the philosophy to lower the budget. They were no longer underneath the state regulations. One, the immediate thing they did, instead of having a librarian and a bookmobile driver, they had one person do both. So they had to find someone who could do both. They found a new graduate down in Madison. Is anyone here Eli Ferris? Anyone who are Eli Ferris? I don't want to say anything. They didn't want to feel bad, but Levi, he applied for the job. He was a recent graduate of Madison, library science. He said on his referendum that he could drive truck. So, he got the job. This is, I got this from the Ephraim Historical Society. By the way, all these small historical societies like Ephraim and Sister Mary, we kind of like to help each other out. I got this from them. They got it from the Milwaukee Journal, June 25th. It says, we can't do that. It says, Door County's new bookmobile driver had an unfortunate beginning. Eli Ferris of Thurston Bay, traveling librarian, tipped over the bookmobile on his first day of work. Now, he might have been certified bookmobile, not even from certified librarian, but that resume that said, truck driver, that's kind of questionable. So here's the Door County bookmobile on the very first time out for Eli and it was very unfortunate, 1953. So, did I miss one here? Hit too many? Oh no, I got okay. Sorry, I think I go back. So, what we're going to be doing now for the next 43 years is take a look at what was going on with someone who knew how to drive a truck. Ralph Arnold, he wasn't a librarian, he wasn't a truck driver. He was a retired chemical engineer. He would go on, and many of us in here know Ralph, or knew Ralph, because we are between age 70 and 75, maybe a few older, but that isn't that our age in here, between 70 and 75? So we would have Ralph. Ralph Arnold, primary librarian, 14 years after retirement as a chemical engineer. So some of you, oh, I can't read that one yet. Look at this fella here.
Yeah. Oh,
I think that might have been my older brother Larry. He's the only one who's trying to read. None of us could read, but he could read. So, does anyone recognize that building in the background? Where that might have been? We're kind of looking for those things. So, you can see the interest in the bookmobile. This is Ralph Arnold. He put 14 years into it. And a very likable person, from what I understand. And the bookmobile service not only had them schools and stores and crossroads like at Whitefish Bay, but they went into Peninsula State Park and took care of campers also. Ralph is here in the background in Peninsula State Park and this news article that I found. Then we're going along pretty quick there. Now up to 1964, we got a telegram. It said, from the company in Wooster, Ohio, that's where the first two were done, that Door County's new bookmobile was completed and ready for driveway. That meant in the telegram driveway that you could take it home. We got that telegram. This time it was a Ford. That Chev lasted from 50 to 64. The Ford's going to last a lot longer. I'm not promoting Ford, but. So, we got a new one. This is the one that John Enigo here got from the North County Library System after they retired it. This is the one we purchased from John. And it's brown on brown, or tan on brown, whatever. So we have to decide how we're going to paint that thing up. So this is the photo of the new one, 1964, fall of 1964. Ralph worked in Edmore a couple of years, three more years, and then decided to discontinue the service and retire. There was a lot of sentiment at this time about whether they should continue or not. The budget things were a big thing, but there are other things that were going on. If you come on July 23rd to Lathrop Smith, I'll tell you about it. But there was a lot of things going on. Then we hired Bob Heilman, a veteran of 21 years as a parts manager in a car dealership. So he worked in at the bookmobile service as the librarian and bookmobile driver from 1967 to 1988. Here's a picture of Bob. I want you to notice something on the door of the library bookmobile. It says free library service. When the library bookmobile started in 1950, previous to that, oh, by the way, above the old Carnegie Library, the old library in Sturgeon Bay, above the door it says free library. That was not free. Only to us city slickers. That was a Sturgeon Bay library. If you lived in the county, you paid a fee to use that library. You paid a fee. Even though it said free, you paid a fee. When the bookmobile service started, in 1950, it became a free library. The bookmobile was important in changing that library system in Door County over to a free library system, because now all of Door County was involved. So that's why you see that very prominent on the door. This is one of my favorite pictures. It has an attitude toward it. These girls are not walking to the bookmobile. I coached track for 33 years. These girls are sprinting to the book. And I think that's an attitude, from what I understand, a lot of people have. That bookmobile pulled up, you couldn't get them in, from stopping to sprint to it. Once they're in there, you couldn't get them out. So these two girls are trucking to the bookmobile. I use this a lot in our promotion because of the attitude of it. But the bookmobile had an attitude toward it. This bookmobile was going around to all the schools, naturally. You know how the elementary schools were up here in the rural? Come Halloween, you have to decorate. They decorated the bookmobile. Come Thanksgiving, unhand the turkeys. They would, and then there might be a special program up at the school in Ellison Bay. They would put their projects on the bookmobile, you know, the pictures and diagrams. That's what I read, I've read about it as far as the attitude of the bookmobile. It brought a lot to Door County. This is the bookmobile we would have expected. The bookmobile would also make stops at numerous church schools and so forth. And I just want to pass on to here that as far south as it went was to the Union Town Hall. That's that little green building that used to be on the old highway before they built the four lane. It's still there. That's the Union Hall, Town Hall, and would stop there. So for whatever the time limit would have, people would come, return their books, and get new books. Another one, this is new. See what I meant? Brown on tan, or tan on brown? We're going to have to see what we can do. We'll at least make it shiny. Here's that Salem Lutheran Church. A little story about Salem. During the summertime, there was an elementary school that must have been fairly close to Salem, but it was on a busy highway in the summertime. Busy road, county road. A lot more tourists down there. And at that time, and the bookmobile driver wanted to get it off the road, so he wanted to come to the parking lot of Salem. But those good Lutheran, and I'm Lutheran, those good Lutheran ladies at the ladies' aid said, no, we don't want the kids in here. They're going to be putting trash in the yard and all that kind of stuff. Well, the minister, who was educated, said yes. So they didn't allow the bookmobile to stop there at Salem. And the ladies didn't want it there, but they were outvoted. Okay, here's just a report. We're up to 1986 now. We have 34 stops. And besides the schools, just like to throw in some of those names that maybe some of you know, some of you don't, some you can throw out more later on. Blythe's Corner, Duval, Four Corners, Liberty Square, or Liberty, Maple Ridge, Innocent Center, crossroads like County Front Key and Matthew Road. They wouldn't stop at County Front Key and Matthew Road because there's a number of people there. I read an article that they actually stopped at some private homes because if you remember back 1950 and so forth, in the 50s, that private home might have had 9 children. And across the street might have been another 5. You've got a whole book and you'll stop right out in some country, on some farm. It changed because the branch libraries in the north are open most of the summer. Branch libraries that we have right downstairs was canceled. Bookmobile service was canceled to Northern Door County. And then in southern, they only do it one day a week, but then they started experimenting with a new system, a band system. So as we go into, here's a letter that says that you know the bookmobile is ready for retirement. After quite careful consideration, a hard look at cost, and much discussion, we have decided to continue very limited bookmobile service. The fourth paragraph says this summer we'll test a new service. And this was sent out to news media. And then the director sent out a memo, August 4th, 1989, announced a retirement party. They were going to retire in the bookmobile, and because they couldn't run. It was running, couldn't get it up the Allison Bay Hill. You could get a final walk through the bookmobile for 25 cents. Now I asked Gary about this, and he said he didn't think it happened because they couldn't get the bookmobile to the parking lot. So this was in 1989. The bookmobile was dead. They couldn't get it to the parking lot. Maybe it happened, maybe it didn't. And you couldn't get the last walk through. In June 14th, 1989, Press Gazette article reported that Door County's bookmobile, the 1964 model, would be replaced by a van. And that's because the bookmobile was worn out. This is what Gary would drive. There's a book van, cargo van. In the back, you can see it had carts with books on. And he would find places where he could stop. I'll pick on Salem again. He stopped and asked if he could stop at Salem where we go to those fish fries. And they said, no. And he had other places that they were stopping at Jackson Brook, but he'd find the spaces where he could stop, wheel the books in. Because now he needed, he didn't have the walk-in bookmobile. He needed a place to get the books unloaded. And people then would come to the place, and they would, as this gentleman is, would have a lot more time to sit and read. But it also, there weren't as many kids anymore.
When they reduced it also, then we would stop for 3-4 hours versus 45 minutes or whatever.
Did you hear that? Mm-hmm. Why don't you just hang on that, because you're going to be answering more questions. Why don't you just mention that's not enough so you can talk.
When it started, it then stayed at a place for 3-4 hours rather than 45 minutes or a half hour, depending on the area they were in. So it did cut off many, many stops, but they, again, were there for a lot longer periods.
So it finally came to an end with the new main Door County Library in Spring Bay. Branch libraries throughout. Is that a echo in here now?
No.
Okay.
No.
And improved school libraries, advanced technology. So the bookmobile service came to an abrupt end with the announcement and the advocate on October 29th, 1996. This is the notice that was appeared. It didn't even go out, Gary, and pick the books up. They had to bring them to Sturgeon Bay, they had to bring them to Forestville, they had to bring them to Brussels. That was it. That was the end of the book van service. So now get into John Anigo, retired teacher, writer, local news, and amateur historian, had the foresight to buy that bookmobile. He moved the bookmobile to his farm in north of Carlsville. John, did you drive it there or did you pull it there?
I had it towed out there. And by the way, the year before the bookmobile, before the bookmobile was retired, I was on Washington Island. I was teaching on Washington Island. And I don't remember that we were asked if we on the island could get the services of the bookmobile. Because I think they were wondering how they would ever get it on the ferry. But they did get it on the ferry, and they took it to the island the year after I was teaching there. But somewhere I lost the communications and never got to me to say anything about it being taken up to the island. I sure would have been for her. We had a library on the island.
You didn't have the books that you needed. So you had towed the car as well. That's a good indication of the shape it was in. One other question, John. Did you just park it there in that tree grove, or did you park it against the tree?
I parked it as close to the tree as I could. My wife said, I don't like it there in front of the tree. I had backed it in or had it unloaded so the back end touched the tree. And then after a few years, she said, I don't like it there. You have to move it so it's on the other side of the tree. So I got my little 550 Oliver out there. And I'll tell you, once I got that tractor and bookmobile moving, I didn't make one stop. I just kept on going and I got where I wanted it.
Okay.
I'm asking for an engine for the bookmobile. And product. By going around to junkyards and having a pickup truck and having this engine in the bed of the pickup truck, maybe they'd find somebody who could say, have you ever seen an animal like this?
Well, yeah, up on the screen, you can see the movement that we had moved down to Carlsville. Oops. Down to Carlsville, and to start the restoration process, John and his wife, and then Charles trucking, I think it was, that pulled it down there for us to Carlsville. And then I took some photos of the inside. It was full of books that John left with us, so we had to remove those books, and we have some of them downstairs in the history room. Those are of historical value. And it's a long process to restore this bookmobile. And here, we moved it in 2015, so it's been 3 years now in the garage. People keep asking me, when is this going to be done? I heard someone said there was some false information about it already. Why don't you just pass this around? Just don't ask me anymore. Just look at this picture. It'll be a while before it's done. Naturally, it takes money to get it done. As I mentioned at the beginning, and that if you want to, you can take a picture of the bookmobile and take this home and bring it back to the show. But anyhow, it's there. The picture, you pass it around and back, and you see the extent that it's at, and its development. One of the important things is the memories. And I want to just mention also that we put together a bookmobile book, which is down in the history room. I want to add one more chapter, and that's the memories. I don't have any memories, you do. Now, what I want you to do is on this brochure you have, inside, there's an address for mailing. Oops, that's okay, I can get it later. For mailing and for emailing. I want you people that have memories to send us as many memories as you can of the bookmobile. Anything that you can think of. Email those to us or send them to us. We can complete a chapter in that book. Also, by the way, that helps you find an address to send any checks you want to send to us. So that's in that brochure. Let's finish up that book with memories. Memories of the bookmobile. Here's a memory from Lisa Bly Harry. Many of you might know her. You don't have to put your name down in the memories, but please put down what you're talking about. Whitefish Bay, or Ellison Bay, or Crossroads someplace, so we know where those come from. Lisa said it stopped at the corner in West Jacksonport between the bar and the old store. We would sit on the steps of the old store the whole 2 hours, and be sure we saw anyone who came there. So that was a two-hour stop, West Jacksonport. Of course, there was a bar across the street. Here's Judy Dexheimer from Sebastian Township. I would take my 5 children in a wagon and books across the highway at 47 and 57. The old Scandia Summer Club, that's not there anymore. Where you people don't know what I'm talking about the stop and go lights down by the mill. There used to be like a triangle in that little area with the Scandia. So she would take her kids with the wagon over to the bookmobile. Here's one here from Jeannie. She lived up on Maple Grove in County F, her school. Only had encyclopedias to read. The bookmobile was a highlight. Her brother Russell would load his arms with books to take home. This is downtown Egg Harbor. I have many fond memories of the bookmobile. I couldn't wait for new selections of mysteries, teen novels. When it was parked at Heatherly's store, that's right where the sign for the village park is. At that time, my grandmother had that store. This, you could almost date this then. When it was parked at Heatherly's store in Egg Harbor, my mom packed me a sandwich, and I would sit on the bus and have lunch with Mr. Arnold. And that was Barbara Perks Kramer. That one we got from Arizona. So it was emailed to us from Arizona. So there are many good memories. Let's put those together and finish this off in the chapter in this book here that you can read at any time down in the history of Rome. So with that, it's not the end of the bookmobile, it's just the beginning. And I would also at this time encourage you, if you have questions or comments, we've got Mr. Gary Allen here, the original last bookmobile driver. I'll give him this bike. Do we have any questions about bookmobiles? Let's have them now. Or experiences, anyone have anything or comments?
How soon do you want the information for that memory?
How do I want?
How soon do you want it? Could we wait till the end of the summer? No, because we could do it like at a neighborhood association meeting because everybody's not here now.
Okay, that's a good question, a good comment. You just said something that brought something in my mind. You shouldn't do that because I have a tendency to bird walk. That means you ever watch a bird in snow, they don't walk in a straight line. Miles and I were talking on Saturday. I also want one more other thing from all of you, not just the bookmobile drivers. What would you be interested in this facility of having like 11 o'clock morning history club? Whether it's 10 people, 15 people, or what I want you to do is send us an email if you have interest in just sitting around and chewing the fat or having programs like this to let us know. Also let us know preferred time, preferred day of the week if you want to do that. So keep that in mind. I had to, Gary and I had a good discussion, but I don't want to leave it. Do any of you have any comments about the bookmobile? Yeah.
Do you have anything when you're talking funding, like a match? Has anybody offered a match anything?
We're very weak in fundraising. That's a good point. We have to see, you mean to match our fundraising?
In other words, I don't know,
you give $50,000, we'll match it. Okay.
No, so my next thing would be, the love of my dad's life are three things: his family, his radios, and his bookmobile and books.
Okay.
So on behalf of them, I would like to donate $250 to have somebody match.
To match that.
I would give $250 if up to $250.
That's a good point. I think we'll have to discuss that and set up a way of promoting that and announcing that. You know, when I was talking to Gary on Monday, my son's a physical therapist, and what I asked him, sometimes his patients bring him things, and when he was living out in the country, one patient brought him a bunch of raspberry bushes to plant. Another patient, his wife would bring him banana bread. So I asked Gary, did anyone ever bring you anything to remember what you were talking about? Did anyone ever bring you anything out to the bookmobile for you?
Just every once in a while, like every other month or every 3 months, somebody come over when I was at a stop around lunchtime and had a sandwich. So that had something to eat because I didn't pack a sandwich at that time. Hopefully I went by a restaurant or a grocery store and would pick up something.
You mentioned apple pie too, which kind of got my mind.
Somebody wants to know who baked it. And I don't know that.
Do you have any questions then? Comments about the bookmobile service? Yes.
What did Gary get paid for that? Just curious.
They're curious about your pay, Gary.
When I first started, it was a dozen and a half eggs and a loaf of bread. No, I can't really tell you now. That's been a long time ago. I had several different jobs since then. But part of the service was cut back because it was only a 30-hour a week job. And so I had to fund my life some other way. So
you didn't work on Thursday.
I didn't work on Thursdays. I changed that.
What part of the bookmobile driver's service, were you best at driving or best at bookmobiling?
I would guess I was best at driving. Anybody who's with the library would probably know, you think you work in a library and all you do is read books all day. Well, you know that isn't true because somebody has to read about the books to know what
each one and every other person would be interested in to order that book and have it in service. So you spend a lot of time reading and researching the magazines that come out with the new books that are available. So it does take your time rather than reading. Plus you have to check them in and check them out and change them and do so forth.
Well, one thing you didn't have to do, like Eli Ferris, you didn't have to go ahead and stock another 2,000 books on the shelves after you rolled the bookmobile open.
You're right, but there was one corner, and I can't tell you where that corner is, that every month I would go by it, and the books from the top shelf would fall off. The thing never went. I don't think the bookmobile went over 35 miles an hour, and I hoped I would always get home with it, because it was just chugging along, so. But I don't know, they would fall off every once in a while.
And you did mention on Monday that everyone, Gary knows how to get all around Door County without going up a hill.
I do. I use the flood map a lot.
And that was because if you wanted to go up elevation, Elson Bay Hill, you couldn't make it, you had to find a back road to go all the way around Big Harbor Hill there. Well, you could go down on front. You have to go down on the front gate to get home instead of going up the hill.
Well, yeah, and that, or I didn't come through Big Harbor much. I always took the bypass. And you know, every town and village in the county is always down in the valley, because you have to go downhill to get to them and uphill to get out of them.
Is there any annual costs that you can remember that the county kind of calculated to provide the bookmobile service?
No, I wasn't involved in that. No.
The opening cost that first year was $30,000. They had the
budget. Was that annually?
Well, that would have been for a year, yeah. $30,000, but I don't know what they continued after that. Okay.
But again, the usage went down because, as he mentioned, some families years ago had 6 to 10 kids, and families were getting smaller, and also the schools had bigger libraries, and there were several branch libraries throughout the county, so it did dwindle down, and it was way more popular in the summertime, so it was used in the summertime by kids. But it, as I said earlier, or in the paper, that you know, I had come with bicycles and cars and horses on horseback and whatever. So it worked out. It was very enjoyable. I never met a bad person or one that was not happy. So.
Anything else? Well, I want to thank Jerry and hope you had an enjoyable morning with us to find out what the book only was about.
Well, I started in 1988. I didn't know all that other stuff that happened.
Well, we want to thank you for coming, and this is our National Bookmobile Day. It's Bookmobile Week, and we are looking for input from you of any kind, whether it's good or bad, whether you want to see things happen here as a continuing basis, whatever. So thank you for coming, and that'll be it for the day. I think it's